Okay, the next speaker would be Dr. Muthiah Periyakarappanan.
It will be Anthony Terrence, madam.
Anthony Terrence, okay. Yeah. So the next speaker will be Dr. Anthony Terrence, who works in, I think he's attached to GKNM Coimbatore, right? Yeah. He's an MD MRCP with the European Diploma in Pediatric Respiratory Medicine. He's a consultant pediatric pulmonologist and a bronchoscopist in GKNM Coimbatore. He has got 15 scientific publications, peer-reviewed journals, and he has got the award of Professor Henry Klammann Award from CMC Vellore in 2009, and then Professional Excellence Award for GKNM Hospital. And he has delivered the Subramaniam Oration in 2018, and his special interest in PCB. And I think he's going to talk a lot about the pneumonia pre-COVID and maybe the post-COVID also. But, over to Dr. Anthony Terrence.
Thank you, madam, for the kind introduction. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir. You can go ahead.
Okay. Respected teachers, fellow pediatricians, and my dear friends, it gives me immense pleasure to be here and talking to you on management of childhood pneumonias. It's a very common topic. And at the outset, I would like to thank IAPTNSC team for organizing this event. And I would also like to thank my teacher, Dr. Gauri Shankar, for this opportunity, excellent opportunity. This is a brief outline of my presentation. In the next 30 minutes, I will try to define pneumonia, and we'll also define the burden of the pneumonia in children. And then we look at management of pneumonia and complication using illustrative case capsules. And this is being a COVID season, COVID era. We'll touch upon COVID disease. And then finally, we'll talk about preventive strategies and then summarize. We all know, but our respiratory tract is silently, fighting off infections. We are continuously exposed to invading. Our respiratory tract is exposed to invading pathogens, but it fights very silently and very efficiently. And how it does is, like, we have a three-layered, defenses. Is the barriers to infection are mechanical barriers we have. We have the innate immunity and adaptive immunity. Has both cellular components as well as molecules. They are efficient in fighting off invading bugs. Therefore, we don't know exactly, what's happening inside. But when the invading organism is smart, or when our immune systems are down, we get an infection. And if we get in the lungs, we call it pneumonia. And what do you mean by pneumonia? Pneumonia is a condition that typically associated with fever, respiratory symptoms, and evidence of parenchymal involvement. This is very important, evidence of parenchymal involvement. This can be elicited just by clinical signs. WHO says we can just go by respiratory rate. This is for healthcare workers. For pediatricians, we need something more lung signs, like reduced air entry, crackles, and a grunt. These are things we need to look at. And when you make a diagnosis based on clinical sign, we call it clinical pneumonia. And if you take an X-ray, if you're able to demonstrate opacities, then you say it's a radiologically confirmed pneumonia. And what is the disease burden? We are making lots of fuss about COVID, but pneumonia is a silent killer. About 1 million children die every year because of pneumonia, and it contributes to 15 to 16% of under 5 child mortality. And where all this mortality happens? In developing countries, sub-Saharan Africa, as well as South Asia. India stands only second next to Nigeria, according to this report. And about more than 1 lakh deaths occur every year in India due to childhood pneumonia. Therefore, we need to do better. We need to have, public health interventions, have to improve. And over the period of from 2000, the good thing is from 2000 till date, the number of pneumonia deaths has been decreasing. That's a good sign. And we'll see illustrative case capsule. This is a 3-year-old child who is unwell for 3 days. And this child presented with fever, cough, and hurried breathing. And on examination, the child is sick looking, normally nourished and tachypneic. If you go by WHO, here itself, we can say it's pneumonia, but child has got severe chest retractions, and we did a pulse oximetry as well. Child is hypoxemic and tachycardic. There was a reduced air entry on the right side. In addition to that, there is crackles and grunt. We all know grunt is, again, a forced expression against a partial that indicates, you know, the child is having a parenchymal lung disease. Therefore, based on this, we can easily make a diagnosis of clinical pneumonia. But as pediatricians, we need to qualify further. Further variables, we have to add further variables. That's very important for the management. The two important variables we have to add is which setting this pneumonia is occurring. That's very important. Therefore, this is a community-acquired pneumonia. This, the patient has acquired infection from the community, not from the hospital. And second is we have to mention the severity. That's very helpful for clinical decisions. Therefore, from looking at the, you know, a clinical signs, you have hypoxemia, severe retractions, and marked tachycardia. This is a severe pneumonia. Therefore, it's important to add the qualifiers, severity as well as setting. Therefore, this is a community-acquired pneumonia, and this is severe pneumonia. What next? As we evaluate, it's very, very important to take care of the ABC. Because child is hypoxemic, we have to give oxygen and, if needed, other respiratory support as well. Once you do that, the important decision, next decision you have to make is whether I am going to treat the child as an outpatient or I'm going to refer the child for admission. Therefore, in case of severe pneumonia, definitely the child will require inpatient treatment. And what are the factors we need to consider to make pneumonia severe? As we already seen, one of the below findings, like severe respiratory distress, severe hypoxemia or cyanosis, marked tachycardia, altered mental state, or if it is a complicated pneumonia, this child will require admission. Apart from this important criteria, severity, other two factors we need to consider in. Even in case of non-severe pneumonia, the child is less than 6 months of age, definitely we need to think about inpatient treatment. And other thing is presence of comorbid conditions. If the child has got heart disease or immunosuppressing condition, definitely we need to refer this patient for admission. And once you made a decision, you know, you started treatment, you decided whether to admit this child or not, the next decision you need to do is like what investigations I am going to do. And another point I missed is like PIC admission, any child requiring respiratory support, oxygen, or if there is hemodynamic instability, you have to admit the child in a PICU. And after admitting this child, the next step is ordering basic investigations. Simultaneously, we start treatment as well. And these were the tests done in our patient. Chest X-ray, labs, we did CBC, CRP, and blood culture. We'll see one by one whether these investigations are appropriate or not. Therefore, what are the indications for doing a chest X-ray in acute pneumonia? Definitely, if the child has got a severe pneumonia recurring hospitalizations, you have to do an X-ray, not for a OPD patient. OPD patient doesn't require an X-ray. And if you have an infant who has high grade of fever, and if you don't know the focus, if you do a blood test, if the patient has got leukocytosis, if the WBC count is more than 20,000, even without other signs, you can take an X-ray to know whether the patient has got pneumonia or not, when the diagnosis is in doubt. When you suspect a complication, definitely you need to take an X-ray. These are the instances where you need to take an X-ray upfront. What about other investigations we have done in this patient? This patient had right upper lobe consolidation with right pleural effusion. And other tests we have done is a CRP and CBC and CRP. And leukocytosis, definitely indicates child has got a bacterial infection, but it's very non-specific. It can, there can be leukocytosis in other situations as well. Even in viral infection, you can have leukocytosis. Leukopenia doesn't necessarily mean viral infection, because of overwhelming bacterial infection, especially with pneumococcus or staphylococcus, you can get leukopenia. It's sometimes a bad prognostic sign. What about inflammatory markers? Again, they are non-specific. CRP and procalcitonin are non-specific. They can be, get a CRP and procalcitonin elevated. Therefore, it can be raised in inflammatory conditions as well. It's not very specific for infection. And what is the value then doing a procalcitonin and CRP? Thing is, if it is very low, the likelihood of a bacterial infection is very less. Especially procalcitonin, if it is less than 0.25 nanograms per ml, the chances of a bacterial infection is very less. But it's very, very expensive. Therefore, it's not absolutely necessary. There are certain situations where when you need to monitor for response, this is quite helpful. You can decide on your antibiotic duration. There are other studies to show antibiotics can be stopped earlier based on procalcitonin. Therefore, to monitor response, it might be useful. But these tests are absolutely, it's not necessary all the time. And what about cultures? We did blood culture, but it's not necessary to do blood culture on an OPD patient or if a child getting admitted in a ward. It's not necessary to do a culture because the yield is very, very low. If the patient is sick and if you feel it's going to be a bacteremic pneumonia, especially in ICU setting, definitely blood culture will be of use. And other problem is, most of the occasions, we will not be able to isolate the bug because children won't expectorate sputum. And we can't do lung puncture and, pleural aspirate or BAL in all the situations. There are indications for it. Therefore, can't do all these invasive tests for all patients with pneumonia. What about nasopharyngeal aspirate? Nasopharyngeal aspirate, we are doing it quite often because of COVID-19. Therefore, it's very useful for viral infections, not for pyogenic bacterial infections. And it's also useful for atypical mycobacteria like mycoplasma, chlamydia, and bordetella is useful. Even with viral infection, if you have a virus in the upper respiratory tract, some viruses like rhinovirus, adenovirus, they can be there for a long time. Therefore, if you get rhinovirus or adenovirus, this test might not be significant. If you get other viruses like influenza, COVID-19, then definitely they are going to be pathogenic. And other thing is co-infection. Nowadays, we talk about viral pneumonia. Therefore, the patient might have a viral infection simultaneously, can have pneumococcal as well as, or a staphylococcal infection in the lungs. Therefore, presence of one virus in the nose doesn't rule out a bacteria in the chest as well. Therefore, these tests have their own limitations. Therefore, how are we going to manage this patient? Therefore, the chance of getting a bug is very low, and to begin with, you won't have details about the bug which is infecting. Therefore, we have to make some scientific guesses or calculated guesses. That's called we are going to give empirical treatment. Empirical treatment is based on two things, which we already said. Two important things is S, setting and severity. In case if it is a community acquired pneumonia, the common pathogen between 2 months to 5 years, we all know strep pneumonia followed by staphylococcus and strep pyogenes. We need to cover for these bugs. If it is hospital acquired pneumonia or healthcare associated pneumonia, it's going to be bugs, drug resistant bugs, mainly gram negative bugs and MRSA from the hospital. And if a patient has got neurological problems, problems with swallowing, and if the patient develops aspiration pneumonia, I think in addition to gram-positive and gram-negative bugs, we have to cover for anaerobic bacteria. Immunodeficiency, they will have all kind of funny organism, opportunistic infections like PCJ and fungal, we need to think about in addition to bacteria and viruses. Therefore, think about when you write a prescription, think about setting and severity before you write the prescription. And what happened to our patient? This is the flow chart for patient admitted with pneumonia in hospital, and we'll see the first line drug is going to be ampicillin, the first line drug, because it has good action against pneumococcus. But there are alternatives. We use third generation cephalosporin, ceftriaxone, it's not bad to use that, or Augmentin we can use. And if there is beta-lactam allergy, we can use levofloxacin if there is allergy. It's a very, very rare scenario. And if it is the patient is admitted in the ward, either one of these drugs, either ampicillin, Augmentin, or ceftriaxone will do. Ampicillin is the drug of choice. And we can manage with single drug. In case if the child is getting admitted in PICU, I think we need to think about MRSA. Therefore, you need to give MRSA coverage. That again depends on presence of drug resistance in your area. In my place, clindamycin resistance is quite high. Therefore, we go for vancomycin. Again, in severe pneumonia, irrespective of age, you need to consider atypical microorganism. Therefore, we do cover for mycoplasma as well. Therefore, we give azithromycin. In case of these are patients, severe pneumonia getting admitted in PICU. And what patient, ampicillin, augmentin, or ceftriaxone will do? And if the patient is allergic to beta-lactams, levofloxacin. And this is antibiotic sensitivity of pneumococcus. This was recently published in 2016. This is an Indian study. And this study clearly shows what are the drugs you should not use. We should not use macrolide antibiotics. I have seen macrolide prescriptions for pneumonia, community acquired pneumonia. Therefore, macrolide, there is high degree of resistance for pneumococcus. Therefore, macrolides better not to use. Cotrimoxol, again, resistance is quite high. And if you see, we already talked about penicillin and cephalosporins. Parenteral cephalosporins are quite good. But in case of oral cephalosporins, their bioavailability is poor. They don't, reach sustained drug levels above MIC. Therefore, oral cephalosporin better to avoid. And there are people using cefixim. It has only gram negative coverage, and it doesn't cover for pneumococcus. Therefore, avoid cephalosporins and macrolides for community acquired pneumonia. And what is the treatment of choice if the patient is treated as an outpatient in your office practice, non-severe pneumonia? The drug of choice is amoxicillin. And WHO recommends high dose amoxicillin. It's not 30 milligram per kg per day. It's 30 milligram per kg per dose, up to 90 milligram per kg per day in 2 or 3 divided doses. For LRTI, 3 divided doses is better than 2 divided doses because the drug levels are maintained above MIC for a longer period of time, and the failure rates will be much less. Why we are using high dose amoxicillin? Because if in case the patient has got intermediate resistance to penicillin, which can be overcome by using a high dose amoxicillin. The alternative drug is amoxiclav. And what is the duration of antibiotics? It's usually 5 to 7 days. But it's very important to ask the patient to come after 48 hours to check for response. That's very, very important. As I said, we have to avoid macrolide antibiotics for community acquired typical bacterial pneumonias. I'm talking only about typical bacterial pneumonias and oral cephalosporins. And this is another child, 5-year-old child. This child presented with pneumonia. And you can see, the right upper lobe opacity. And therefore, this is a clinical pneumonia and a radiologically proven pneumonia. Child was put on augmentin. And after 48 hours, child didn't have a clinical response. Fever was persisting, but simultaneously the patient had a rash. And this rash was erythematous, but areas there was vesicular rash as well. And in the presence of atypical features, like skin finding or ear issues, ear infection, or arthralgia, anemia, all those atypical features, you need to consider mycoplasma. Therefore, we did a PCR. This is from the nasopharynx. And this patient was positive for mycoplasma. Therefore, this patient was appropriately treated with macrolide antibiotics. When you have in a clinical setting of atypical pneumonia, you can treat for mycoplasma better after confirmation. Therefore, consider mycoplasma when the patient presents the atypical features and severe pneumonia. And we'll move on to the next case capsule. This is a 3-year-old child treated for CAP. Fever, the child presented with fever despite being treated with IV antibiotics for 5 days. In this setting, there are 3 considerations, whether we have not given appropriate antibiotics or adequate dose. And second thing is presence of complications and alternative diagnosis. We have ruled out inadequate antibiotic therapy. Patient received appropriate adequate antibiotic therapy. There was no alternate diagnosis. Therefore, the screening investigation in this scenario is doing a test X-ray. We have already seen in case of suspected complication, we do an X-ray. Therefore, with an X-ray, we can see a pleural collection on the right side, Once you have a pleural collection, we need to define further, whether the quantity of the fluid, that's very, very important for decision making. And pleural effusion, there are 3 stages, which stage we are in. And third thing, if at all, if you are putting an ICD, where to site the ICD. And for these 3 questions, ultrasound just gives good answer. Therefore, if you have a pleural disease, especially pleural effusion, ultrasound chest is the investigation. Don't do a CT scan. And this patient had a loculated effusion. I was talking about pleural stages of pleural effusion. Pleural infection is a continuum. And during the first week, it's usually exudative effusion, which will be a free-flowing fluid. Here, treatment is mainly antibiotics. But if the effusion is large and if the patient is having respiratory distress, we have to put a chest drain. The second stage usually occurs during the second week. Therefore, it's important time and by mass. Second week, usually you see septations or loculation. In the presence of patients and loculation, and if the effusion is significant, we have to drain it. And here, just putting ICD might not be, you know, helpful. We have to do fibrinolysis, either medical fibrinolysis or surgical fibrinolysis, depending on the center's experience. We have a very good VATS surgeon, Professor Rajamani. Therefore, we go for VATS. And usually they do well. The outcome is very good. But if the patient is, you know, treated with antibiotics for more than 2 weeks, and if the pus gets organized, it's organization stage. And what it does is forms a fibrous peel along or around the lungs, and the lungs can get trapped in the peel. Therefore, in this stage, we have to do release the lung. Therefore, we have to go for thoracotomy. Here, VATS won't work. We have to go for thoracotomy and do decortication. Our patient was diagnosed in stage 2, therefore had VATS and recovered well. And this is again a child treated for pneumonia, poor response to therapy. If you see, you can see haziness in the left, you know, lower zone. And ultrasound was done. There was no significant effusion, but ultrasound suggestive of lung abscess. Therefore, if you want to, you know further about the parenchymal lesion, CT scan will be the best investigation. If you want to look at the parenchyma. Therefore, this patient had a lung abscess. How do you treat a lung abscess? 95% of the time, lung abscess responds to your antibiotics. As we have to cover for gram-positive, gram-negative, and mainly anaerobes. And in the setting of lung abscess, it's important to check whether the patient has aspiration risk or the patient has got an underlying congenital malformation, which CT scan will give the answer. The CPAM or sequestration can present as lung abscess. We treated this patient conservatively, but this patient didn't respond to medical management. Very rarely, like we have to intervene. This patient had CT-guided aspiration of the abscess, and this child improved really well. And this is another child treated for left sided pneumonia, empyema. The lung lower lobe is not expanded. You can't see the diaphragm on the left side. And this patient, therefore, we subjected for bronchoscopy, because in this situation, there are two possibilities. It could be a foreign body with secondary pneumonia or something blocking like a mucus plug. Therefore, we wanted the answer. We did bronchoscopy, and the bronchoscopy showed thick purulent material, no foreign body. It was suctioned out, and immediately there was good lung expansion. Therefore, bronchoscopy has a role in certain complicated pneumonia, not all patients. And this is necrotizing pneumonia. Necrotizing pneumonia is again caused by the same bugs what we have told for community acquired pneumonia, but it could be the virulent strains of these bugs. And what we have to do differently in this particular thing is, like, we have to consider drug resistant bugs. We have to treat with antibiotics. There is no need for any intervention. And for necrotizing pneumonia, you might need to give antibiotics for a prolonged period of time, okay? For same bugs, but could be more virulent strains. No need for any surgical intervention. They usually respond to antibiotics, but you need to give for a regular, a longer period, and you need to cover drug-resistant bugs as well. And complicated pneumonia, medical management, we have, individually we have seen, but generally empirical, we have to give, as I said, depending on the type of complication, we might need to extend the empirical coverage. And second thing is the duration of antibiotics, you know, is usually up to 4 weeks you have to give. And it's not necessary in uncomplicated pneumonia to do a repeat chest X-ray. Here, in this situation, after completion of antibiotics, you have to confirm resolution by doing a repeat chest X-ray. There are other indications for repeat chest X-ray. Dr. Sharath's, you know, topic, recurrent or persistent symptoms. Or if you have a down pneumonia, definitely you have to do a repeat chest X-ray to confirm resolution. And viral pneumonias, like viral infections, are most frequent cause of pneumonia in children under 5 years. Viral pneumonias can have co-infection with bacteria, and viral infection also predisposes to secondary bacterial infection because it damages your airway defenses and your pathogenic bacteria are waiting in the nose to invade. Therefore, you can have secondary bacterial infections. That's very, very important. Therefore, to begin with, it could be a viral infection. Therefore, you need to, even in a viral infection, you have to monitor them closely. They can have secondary bacterial infections. And as we already discussed, PCR of respiratory samples is quite helpful. We actually, in our center, we looked at PCR samples sent for, multiplex PCR sample sent for LRTA. We looked at 60 patients, 69 patients, retrospective study. We found RSV being the commonest, followed by influenza A and B, para-influenza, and Boca viruses. And other thing, what we noted is the peak of RSV occurs earlier, September, October, compared to influenza in our place during the study. Influenza peak occurred in January and February. Therefore, RSV peak occurs earlier. These are the two things we learned from this retrospective study, and it was published in Sri Lankan Journal of Childhood. And what about COVID pneumonia? Does it behave like a viral pneumonia? And there is a study from China looking at a cohort of viral pneumonias and a cohort of COVID-19. What they found is quite interesting, and this is what we see as well. Mostly the COVID infections, they get infected from one of the adult family members. It's not like usually child to child, it's usually from adult family member, they get the infection. The median age, if they present with respiratory infection, the median age is slightly higher, 6 years, compared to viral infection. Other viral infections, 3.2 years. And lower proportion of severe cases. They actually evaluated 40 COVID patients and found only one patient had a severe COVID disease compared to other viral infections. And the number of severe cases were slightly higher. Therefore, severity is less in children. And other important finding, and we also observe, we don't get pneumonias, bacterial pneumonias nowadays. Secondary bacterial infection following COVID diseases were lower. Therefore, with influenza, you get secondary bacterial infection. With COVID, chance of secondary bacterial infection is very less. And symptom duration is less compared to other viral infections. These are quite interesting findings. And we all know, the radiological finding is ground glass opacity is located mainly in the lower lobe and peripheral subpleural location. Like adults, they can also have children. If you do a CT scan, they'll also have the same kind of ground glass opacities, but we don't do CT scan regularly for this patient. And inflammatory markers are lower in COVID pneumonia, COVID infection compared to other viral infections. And IAP has published recently in the April issue guidelines for management of COVID-19 disease. They classify COVID-19 disease into mild, moderate, and severe. Within the severe category, there is a category of critical disease. What is mild? Any child presenting with just symptoms without any signs, like fast breathing, is a mild disease. The patient had signs of pneumonia or hypoxemia, it's a severe, it's a moderate disease. And if the patient had features of severe pneumonia or general danger signs like lethargy, seizures, somnolence, or GI symptoms, it is severe disease. What is critical disease? Critical disease is organ failure, either ARDS or shock or multi-organ dysfunction or acute thrombosis classified as severe disease. How it helps with the management? For mild disease, we all know what we generally do is we talk about supportive care. We talk to the parents about supportive care. We need to isolate the child because we don't want the infection to spread. Therefore, prevention of transmission is very, very important. Third thing is, we don't investigate them to begin with. We wait for 3 days. Usually 3 to 5 days, they settle down. But during review, if you find the child is continuing to have fever or if there is worsening, we need to evaluate. Therefore, it's not necessary to investigate at the beginning all these children. Therefore, usually supportive care, monitor for complication and prevent transmission by isolation. And these children are treated as OPD. But if there are risk factors, like immunocompromising condition, or the child needs to be monitored, you can admit this patient. Moderate disease, you need to admit this patient in a COVID ward. And moderate disease with hypoxemia, that is indication, which is mainly extrapolated from adults. to give, apart from oxygen, dexamethasone, 0.15 milligram per kg, 5 to 10 days. This is from adults. And you also consider, if the patient has risk factors, giving remdesivir and antimicrobials. Investigations, basic investigation, CBC, CRP, and a chest X-ray, and renal function and LFT. And if it is a severe or critical disease, you need to admit this child in a PICU setup. And you need to evaluate for organ function. Apart from whatever treatment, oxygen, respiratory support, IV steroids, consideration for remdesivir and antimicrobials, here might give, you know, enoxaparin, low molecular weight heparin. And if the patient has got organ failures, we need to support that as well. And pneumonia can be fatal. You know, even community acquired pneumonia can be fatal. I vividly remember this patient. This is an adopted child. And this child presented with community acquired pneumonia, severe pneumonia ICU. And we treated, but the patient didn't respond to our treatment, required ventilation. There was failure of ventilation and cellular pneumothorax. And we eventually did ECMO for this patient. And the child was on ECMO for 7 days. Child couldn't be revived. It was a very sad story. And retrospectively thinking about this patient, we always felt that this child should have received a pneumococcal vaccine, which child didn't receive. Therefore, prevention is very, very important in pneumonia. Therefore, it's very, very important to vaccinate children for preventable diseases, especially pneumococcal vaccine. In countries where they have introduced pneumococcal vaccine, they have found the, you know, mortality has reduced dramatically by more than 50%. The number of infections also has reduced dramatically because the number of infections have reduced. There was reduced usage of antibiotics. And the reduced usage of antibiotics resulted in, you know, less emergence of resistant strains. Therefore, vaccination is very, very important. Other vaccines which are of relevance are hip vaccine, pertussis vaccine, measles vaccine, and flu vaccine. During this COVID time, it's very, very important. Whenever a patient comes for follow-up, we have to check the vaccination status and vaccinate. And what we have learned from this COVID-19, COVID-19 has taught us very good lessons, you know, what we are doing to the nature. This is the comparison photo of, you know, pre-COVID times in Delhi. You can see Indira Gate on the left side. And during the lockdown, you can see the air quality has substantially improved. Even when they measure the PM2.5, it has dropped for more than four times the pre-COVID levels. Therefore, we have to be gentle with the nature. And you know, if you are not gentle with the nature, and Newton's third law will apply. For every action, there will be equal and opposite reaction. Practically, we also see the number of asthma exacerbations have come down dramatically. We have not done a study, but this is something what we see practically as well. And second thing, what we see is number of respiratory infection because of simple measures like masking, hand washing, and social distancing. The number of infections have come down, respiratory infections have come down dramatically. This is an Australian study comparing previous years from 2017, show a dramatic drop in empyemas as well as bronchiolitis. Therefore, the infections have come down. Therefore, if you are gentle with nature, I think, we ourselves follow respiratory hygiene, that's going to improve the respiratory health of our patients. Summarizing, while prescribing antibiotics, we have to exert caution. For viral URS, don't prescribe antibiotics. If it is a community-acquired pneumonia in the outpatient practice, just prescribe amoxicillin. Macrolides are not, macrolides and cephalosporins are not recommended. If you identify a severe pneumonia, early referral can save lives. And preventive strategies are very, very important. This cannot be done by individual. Therefore, IAP as an organization, you know, has to be an advocate for, you know, child health, especially respiratory health, and force for introduction of universal PCV immunization, clean air, clean water, good nutrition to our kids. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Stop sharing your slides. Dr. Nerinjalian sir has asked, what are the poor prognosticators for the outcome amongst community acquired pneumonia as on date in our setting?
Poor outcome measures like if the child has a complicated pneumonia, definitely the outcome is going to be poor. And some studies have looked at biomarkers having very high CRP, looking at the mortality. Again, the prognosis is going to be poor. And other, if the child has underlying malnutrition, again it's again a prognostic factor. So these are the things offhand I know, actually, yeah.
Dr. Vinod has asked, the dose of enoxaparin in children, where it is in the where it is indicated in COVID?
I need to check the dose. Offhand, I don't know. Thank you.
Actually, what are the indications for remdesivir in COVID-19 pneumonia?
Actually, like, I don't have much experience using remdesivir. I heard a talk from CMC Vellore. They don't use it as well. Only in high-risk situations, if the child is having immunosuppression in the first week, even replication, if the child has got severe disease, definitely, moderate or severe disease, you need to consider on a case-to-case basis. Like, it's not, indicated for all the patients. You have to consider for a severe patient as well as moderate severe patient, especially if they have additional risk factors, on a case-to-case basis.
One more question, sir. Is injection ampicillin widely available?
I think it's available. I think government hospitals, they are very ethical. We are not as ethical private setups. We use augment in most of the time, but you people are very ethical. It's available. Yeah.
So actually, somebody has asked about the remdesivir. We are not, last COVID first wave, we had ICHS in 1,200 patients, including the home quarantine. And we did not require remdesivir and all that so much. In the second, we were seeing most of them are asymptomatic and home quarantine. We have used only for 3. So as